turn, call time, walk out to the mound. He'd say, Glenn, come on, throw strikes. Oh, why don't you say something earlier? I wouldn't have done this if I... You should have told me you wanted me to throw strikes. You know, of course I'm trying to throw strikes, you jerk. Get out of here, you know.
Lucky for us, he stepped off the mound and into broadcasting. He started small, really small, at a radio station in Millville, New Jersey. Then he moved back home to WFIL Radio in Philadelphia. But it was when Glenn started in TV that his career really took off. After 1 year as a sports reporter in Huntington, West Virginia, he was snapped up as a sports anchor at KYW in Philadelphia. And just 1 year later, in 1977, he joined us here at Channel 9. Glenn's work in the sports department has been recognized again and again, with several Emmy Awards and two Sportscaster of the Year Awards from his peers in the industry. We all feel privileged and grateful to have worked with Glenn for lots of reasons, not the least of which were his talent and professionalism, his innovation and dedication. But more than anything else, Glenn could make us laugh. How he could make us laugh. His sense of humor, his joie de vivre, were infectious.
I gotta tell you something. I'm walking through the newsroom and there's Gordon Peterson in the newsroom watching the show. I said, what's wrong with this picture? He said, he has a sore throat. I just gotta say one thing to you, buddy. You call yourself a Marine?
I have a phone message here for JC. The hostess from Shanghai Gardens called, said she needs the dress back by 7 o'clock. I just wanted to pass that along.
Good to see you, Sammy. Take care, buddy. That's not it. Sammy, take care, buddy. That's not it. Gordo, baby, you know I love you. Get away from me with that cigar. I lost my place. Think Hank rings easy? Try it now, pal. Go ahead, big shot. Try it now. There you go. See how easy it is now.
This is ridiculous. This is the most embarrassing thing I've ever done in 13 years of the station, without a doubt. Weenie of the month, Tuesday.
After I whip him and knock him out, you're going to see senior citizen with head rags on running down the street, teenagers jumping behind bushes saying, what's become of the country? I'm going to tear the whole world up. The whole thing is going to change. Only because
he certainly perked up after the food arrived, didn't he?
I need some bread.
Don't we all?
You got me.
Go ahead, get it over with.
Well, I mean, I'm concerned that the entire area was concerned about your whereabouts.
How do you know?
A lot of you may be wondering, were wondering up until a few minutes ago, the whereabouts of anchorman Gordon Peterson. Well, Eyewitness News has learned he was stuck in the elevator of Broadcast House between the fourth and fifth floor in an exclusive interview. I spoke with Gordon just moments ago.
There he is. You can see him.
Could you send some real skinny food in here?
Hey, go. Yo! You're gonna be out of oxygen in about 2 minutes, buddy. But don't worry, you'll be all right. He's doing a great job. I just talked to some of the maintenance guys. They figure they'll have you out by the weekend.
It's good to have you back, safe and sound in one piece, buddy. And I know we're big guys. Come on.
Tell some news.
I'm not afraid to show my affection.
Glenn also had a serious side, a side that many didn't see. When he labored over every segment, he struggled to find just the right word to say, the right question to ask, to make all of his shows the best he could make them.
Isn't that, John, when somebody, I see, that's what I keep coming back to. The easy thing for you to do is call a press conference the next day and say, we've talked to the guys, and it's not going to happen again, and you'd rather eat a bug than do that.
Exactly right. That is exactly right. Because I think it's hypocritical. I don't think, if I go to you...
Is it hypocritical or is it just, it's the competitor? It's the orneriness. You're not going to give him the satisfaction?
It's a little bit of both.
You know, I'm no psychologist or psychiatrist or someone who understands this necessarily, but I think most people do drugs or alcohol because they want to feel better. Now, you look at the situation you had on paper, it was ideal. All pro, $500,000 a year, hero to millions. You were on top of the world. What did you need to feel better about?
Well, Glenn, all those things are material things, right. You know? I mean, happiness comes from within. You know, you have to have your self-identity. Right. But see, if they take that football away, then who would I be?
If you could ask Doug Williams a question as a fan, what would it be if you had one shot at asking him a question? What do you want to know?
Well, Doug, I just want you to tell my kids, Little Ray, Jarrell, and Damon to clean their rooms up and give me some more great football in the Super Bowl.
Well, Ray, you're going to get a lot of that. And believe it or not, I'm going to be watching you on June the 12th. And don't give me no heart attack like I was out in Vegas when you was fighting Hagler.
Oh, I'm sharp, man.
Hey, but
Glenn, come and see me, Glenn.
I'm going out for coffee. You guys have taken over here.
One of Glenn's claims to fame is his style, the creative force behind Weenie of the Week, Encore Wednesday, Mystery Prognosticator, and countless other pieces that made his shows engaging to everyone, sports fans or not.
It's going to be a lot of fun to watch. This is a Red Byrne from Redskins Park for Eyewitness Sports.
Okay, what's the bottom line on this now?
I just think that they have to win. They have to win tomorrow, all right? It all starts there. Can you believe a man who calls himself a professional would wear a hat like that while out there in the field?
No, I
find it hard to believe myself.
I'm a little embarrassed by it. Actually.
Absolutely. I'm talking to a group of people who are not that interested in what I have to say. Statistically, they've proven that. So what I want to do is keep their interest. And the way I can best do that is to relate to them. There's nothing I can think of that attracts me like broadcasting does. You know, I just really feel I was cut out to do this.
Center. That's 111 Michigan Avenue Northwest. The zip code is 20010. And Best Buddies of America Incorporated, 1350 New York Avenue Northwest. And their zip code is 20005. If you would like to send a note of sympathy to Glenn's family, you may send it to the Brenner family, care of WUSA-TV, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue Northwest, Washington, D.C., and our zip code is 20016.
Channel 9's Bruce Johnson headed out of the station this morning with photographer Klein Mengel. Just about everywhere they went, they found people stunned by the news of Glenn's death.
Hey, look at this. He looks like an anchorman for SeaWorld, doesn't he? Huh? Where'd you get this? Real shy did this? Did he do that to you?
The 6 o'clock news was never the same in Washington after Glenn Brenner took over the sports desk for Eyewitness News.
Hanson, let me jump up in it. What were you thinking when you left the house this morning? This looks nice, huh? This'll work.
On the streets today, people remembered Glenn.
He had a great sense of humor, and that shows somebody that thought things throughout. When you have a sense of humor, it's a good sign of an individual's inner feelings and personality.
We went back to the Bethesda Sport and Health Club, where Glenn showed up every weekday morning as part of his training for the Marine Corps Marathon.
And many of the people didn't even realize he was a celebrity at times, and they would come out and say what a nice guy he was. He always had a kind word to say to somebody. He was always positive and upbeat when he was working out, and he always made us feel good at the front desk. And as I've said, the members here, I mean, everybody's totally devastated by it.
In downtown Washington, we talked with bicycle messengers who were grounded by today's water main break.
Mr. Shane, he's a young man. Makes me think. I'm 40.
How you hit them? Huh? I don't usually kiss my golfing partner. But... How you doing? Good looking bag.
You sitting with me?
The golf sweater. You been hitting some balls, have you?
Yeah. I hit a
it's that new radon shaft you got working here.
He was by far the funniest man in Washington television, perhaps in all of TV.
My friend Glenn Brenner passed away today, G.
Yeah, I heard about that first thing at 7:14 this morning, wasn't it?
Dang, I'm sorry to hear that. I like those.
Glenn Brenner, that was my man. Nice. There he was.
Yeah.
Funny, too. He kept you laughing.
Yeah, I liked him, because he was a good sports announcer. He was real nice.
In the Channel 9 newsroom today, the cameras were turned around on the people who normally gathered the news. Professional counseling was made available for people who needed it. News director Dave Pierce said in part in a written statement that Glenn was a true professional and a good friend. I will miss him. D.C. Mayor Sharon Pratt Kelly had these comments.
Well, it's a profound loss to this community. I mean, Glenn had such a great wit, such a great sense of humor. His weenie of the week, and he was really an inspiration to everybody. I mean, it's quite a statement that so many folks of competing television programs viewed him with such great admiration and affection. And that's a tough thing to do in this town, and he will be a hard act to follow.
Hey, don't forget, it offers a financial shot in the arm to our local economy.
I want a baseball team so young people can see their role models and heroes go to prison.
We'll miss you, Glenn. Bruce Johnson, Channel 9, Eyewitness News.
It was part of Glenn's job to report on professional athletes, and in doing so, he made good friends along the way. Well, today, many of the people Glenn covered took time out to remember him. Ken Meese reports.
JC, as the athletic and media reaction to Glenn's death comes to us, there are a few obvious threads that run throughout. The talk of his style, his talent, his humor, and his absolute love of life.
I really enjoyed Glenn as a person and as a sportscaster in Washington. To me, his whole style was so unique. I mean, he made sports so much fun. And I know any time that he interviewed me, he always would say at the end of the interview, "David, you're so serious." And then he would just have a laugh like it's only a game. And he had a great attitude about the game of sports.
It's not like Glenn wasn't an athlete. You know, he was a pitcher in the minor league system. He played basketball in high school. And so he was a competitor. But at the same time, he knew the place of sports in society.
The things that I will remember about Glenn is a smile. I mean, there wasn't a time I didn't see him that he didn't have a smile on his face. He was always joking. I never saw him down. And that really sticks with me, and that's the thing that I will remember the most.
Terrific sense of humor. As a caring, loving, compassionate person, he never took himself too seriously, and he kind of lived life the way it should be.
I'll always remember Glenn because he added humor to sports casting, and that's something that, you know, so oftentimes people just report the sports and tell you the scores and you really get very little out of it. But I think Glenn certainly enjoyed doing his business and giving you a different side, a lighter side of sports. And you know, somewhere in the near future, some other fortunate people are going to have the opportunity to have a sportscaster coming to them that will give them the insight, and he'll also provide them with a weenie of the week.
I used to see how hard he worked. I mean, he'd sit back in that office and toil over a script, not just to make it funny, but to make it work and to make it appealing to his audience. And I think that's why he was a star, because everybody laughed with Glenn Brenner.
I had dinner with Glenn once. It's funny, our life passes so fast. I've been here for 11 years, knew Glenn the whole time. He was a guy that I think I would like to go out and spend some time with, but I'm doing what I'm doing, he's doing what he's doing, and life passes so fast. I think that's maybe something we can all learn from this. You know, we need to stop and take time.
If you ever hear any of the other sports guys say, "Well, I don't watch the other guy because I don't really care," that may be true. That wasn't me, because I wanted to watch Glenn because he was so good.
I think he's telling Jesus a lot of funny stories. I think he's entertaining him up there.
There's no question of the impact that Glenn Brenner had on the fabric of life in this city. More affirmation of that fact in about an hour and a half on Eyewitness Sports, about 6:45, Glenn's time of day. Bob, J.C.
President Bush issued a statement this afternoon expressing his sorrow over Glenn's death. The statement says, "Barbara and I are
grateful. I wanted to watch Glenn because he was so good."
I think he's telling Jesus a lot of funny stories. I think he's entertaining him up there.
There's no question of the impact that Glenn Brenner had on the fabric of life in this city. More affirmation of that fact in about an hour and a half on Eyewitness Sports, about 6:45, Glenn's time of day. Bob, J.C.
President Bush issued a statement this afternoon expressing his sorrow over Glenn's death. The statement says, "Barbara and I are greatly saddened by the untimely death of Glenn Brenner, a man whose wit and ability has endeared him to so many Washingtonians. The sadness of his death and the warmth of his personality leave all of us with a painful emptiness. Sometimes we think we know television's personalities better than we really do, but Glenn Brenner's life and his many friends demonstrate that the man we saw was real, a man who loved his work, his family, and the community he served. We will remember him for those qualities that made him so special. Barbara and I offer our prayers and sympathy to his family and friends."
We'll be back with more in a moment.
Well, his tone, and he was very interesting. He made me watch because I couldn't turn away when I would look at him. It just kept me interested.
Come too soon.
more coffee, Mr. Brenner?
No, thanks, Gene. Now, that'll be all. Just take the check, please.
That'll be $4.35.
Okay, thank you. Could you just hold this for a second, please? Thank you.
Here. This is a general manager spot.
Not anymore, Polly.
WUSA Sports, home of Glenn Brenner, the Emmy Award-winning sportscaster. Can I help you?
Morning, little people.
Hello again, I'm Bob Aldridge.
I'm J.C. Hayward. 2 months ago, as Glenn Brenner finished the Marine Corps Marathon, his life changed suddenly. Doctors diagnosed a cerebral hemorrhage and predicted a full recovery. 3 days ago, doctors had a much more serious diagnosis, a previously undetected brain tumor described as malignant and inoperable. Glenn Brenner died this morning at age 44. He leaves his wife, Susie, their three children, Amy, Ashley, and Matthew, and his parents. He also leaves a stunned and a saddened family here at Channel 9, and of course thousands and thousands of friends who never actually met Glenn.
For many people, the best way to deal with grief is to talk about it, and that's how the morning started when word spread that Glenn had died. Chris Gordon reports.
It just doesn't seem like the same this year. We're all glad that the Skins are there. We hope and know they're going to win the Super Bowl. But we're sure going to miss Glenn.
Yeah, thanks for the call. I appreciate it, Dan.
Thank you.
A steady stream of callers lit the switchboard at WMAL Radio today. Listeners who felt they knew Glenn Brenner personally, and some who did.
I remember when his first child was born. I was working at the hospital at the time. I was also there when his second daughter was born and saw such joy. He was just the most pleasant person to speak to and just be there and see his joy of having those two little girls and having the little one on his arm when the second one was born.
To spend time with Glenn was a joy, even when you became the butt of his jokes.
He invited me to be on the Glenn Brenner Show. He was trying to help me with answers to questions, and I kept striking out with all this trivia stuff. Finally, he helped me enough that I at least got the last one right so I wouldn't go zero. The next day, he calls me. He says, Chaz, how'd you enjoy that appearance on the Glenn Brenner Show? I said, I loved it, Glenn. It was terrific. He says, well, I hope you enjoyed it because that was the last one.
Charlie Brotman handled public relations for the Kemper Open, tennis tournaments, and Sugar Ray Leonard. He also is past president of the Touchdown Club.
The annual Touchdown Club Awards dinner is this coming Saturday night at the Sheraton Washington, and we're dedicating this entire banquet. It's the 57th annual Touchdown Club Awards banquet in memory and in honor and in tribute to Glenn Brenner. We've never done this before, and he's taken such an active role in the Touchdown Club in the past that we felt that we really wanted to do this. And we're not putting a maudlin mood on this dinner because Glenn was not a down guy.
Mo Siegel has been a sports writer, columnist, and commentator here in Washington since before gunpowder, it seems. He has seen TV sportscasters come and go.
If Glenn wasn't the original, he was certainly unique, and I think he had the absolute perfect approach to sports in Washington, where our sports are not so hot. Glenn, I regarded as a sort of Henny Youngman of sports announcers, a sort of a funny guy who wrapped himself around a few baseball and football scores, and thank God he wasn't one of those three runs, four hits, one error. He had a great sense of humor. He had a great impact on this town, and I'm terribly saddened over Glenn's death and express my heartfelt sympathies to the Brenner family, to Channel 9, and to the millions of viewers that love Brenner.
Redskins team owner Jack Hankook and Glenn had a special relationship.
Glenn Brenner's the personality and the kind of man you just simply don't forget. So long as I live, I'll be reminded. Little instances will occur. I think, I wonder what Glenn would have said about that. He was something.
He was something. For many of us who knew him, the marathon may have been a metaphor for Glenn's life. He trained so hard for 2 years. He ran it and he finished the race. It brings to mind a passage from the Bible, from Paul's letter to Timothy. I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. Glenn did all that. Bob, J.C.?
He certainly did. You know, Glenn's family requests that instead of flowers, donations be made to Glenn's favorite charities in his memory. Cindy DiBiase has more on the three charities designated by the Brenner family.
J.C., the three charities the Brenner family has chosen are Children's National Medical Center, Children's Inn, and Best Buddies of America. Glenn was active in these charities, doing everything from broadcasting shows like Redskin Sidelines from Children's Hospital to donating the proceeds from his pro celebrity golf tournament. Today, people at those organizations remembered him.
Glenn Brenner has been an amazing supporter of Best Buddies, and he came on from the beginning when no one knew about Best Buddies or what it was. Not only did Glenn participate on the committee, but he's been actively involved ever since, actually coming to the ball and participating. This past year, he was the active MC in our auction, and he's just been a supporter from day one and has really given we as Best Buddies staff members confidence and energy and motivation to continue doing what we believe in.
Glenn was a very special person in so many ways, as you certainly know. He added courage and heart and hope to a place that needs all of those ingredients, the Children's Inn at NIH. He embodied that spirit. He brought it to us. It was so deep and genuine in him. We will miss him deeply. We will remember him always.
Once again, anyone who would like to remember Glenn through a donation is asked to send a contribution in Glenn's honor to Children's Inn, that's at 7 West Drive, Bethesda, Maryland, 20814. Children's National Medical Center, 111 Michigan Avenue Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20010. And Best Buddies of America, 1350 New York Avenue Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20005. And if you'd like to send any letters to the Brenner family, you can send them in care of WUSA-TV, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue Northwest. That's Washington, D.C., 20016. We'll have more on the three charities that the Brenner family selected tonight on Eyewitness News at 6. Bob, J.C.
Thank you, Cindy. Eyewitness News continues in a moment.
Well, you know, he was just like a great guy. I mean, I really can't say I know a lot about him. He, his son played a soccer game against my little brother, and he was at the game, and, you know, he was real nice there. You know, people would go up and ask him questions, so. No, I can just say he's a great guy. You just watch him on television. He was always nice. He brought, like, energy to the show. And it, like, you know, it's just fun to watch him. I mean, I know my parents, you know, always watch Channel 9, basically just to watch Glenn Brenner mostly, because, you know, he's so fun to watch.
Homes every weekday night around dinner time. Today, many of Glenn's viewers feel like they've lost a friend. Nancy Mathis reports.
Being a part of the Channel 9 news team is like being part of a big, boisterous family. For a lot of us, Glenn was a kind of big brother who always managed to get away with things we wouldn't even think of trying.
If you indulge me just a second, you know, I've been experimenting with glasses. I've been wearing glasses on the air. I got my glasses today. I've decided to go with them. Just tell me honestly. I mean, don't spare my feelings. Tell me what cameras did, too. How do you think they look? What do you think?
He was a big kid, the guy who wore a coat, tie, and sweatpants to work. We have lost a part of our family, and you have lost a friend.
Did I tell you guys about my speaking fee, by the way?
Yeah.
Did your teacher mention it? It's $500.
No.
So do you have any lunch money left? Do you have any,
Yeah.
How much lunch money? How much money you got on you? Here, I'm going to give you a little advice on homework. Do what I do. Yeah. Skip it. Come in. Steal somebody else's, turn that in.
Did you ever get any F's on your report card?
Did I ever get any F's on my report card? Well, let me ask you guys that question. Do I look like a guy who would get F's on his report card?
Yeah.
Good judges of character.
I keep trying to work today, thinking about it all day long, about it. You know, and I heard it this morning. And it just,
Believe me, you just lost for words.
This morning, police dispatcher broadcast over the First District Channel that Glenn Brenner had passed away.
What I miss about him is how happy he was and how, you know, how he was dedicated to, you know, to Washington.
I mean, you know, I wasn't really like a big sports fan, but every time I watched, I thought he was really nice and he was funny and he always seemed cheerful and he seemed like someone that you'd really like to know, you know, as a friend.
I met him off and on. I work at the Capitol Center sometimes, and he would come do his stories, report his stories. He was just a nice person, you know.
Glenn never met a lot of his friends. They didn't live in the same neighborhood.
He was very clear. He was very thorough. He was very committed to his job. You know, it was a pleasure to sit and listen to this fellow.
And they all worked at different jobs.
You could relate to him. It seemed like you were talking to a friend of yours or something, you know, more on a personal level. Just the way he came off with it, you know, you just felt like, well, is that somebody if I ran into, we could become friends right then and there on the spot, you know. That's basically what separated him from, you know, the other sportscasters or any people giving the news, really.
The weenie of the week, that's a classic. And we, especially in the bar business, we would just, there's the weenie of the week. So we thought of him a lot as far as just always, like say the one-liners and the weenies and the silly things. He was very, very down to earth. Really somebody you could really relate to.
The weenie of the month. That was the best. Yes. Love the weenie of the month.
What all of Glenn's friends shared was a sentiment. They all loved him.
I don't think it's easy to do this job for anybody, but if anybody had seemed effortless in the way they did it, it was Glenn. Just because he had the natural ability to communicate with people, as natural as anybody I've ever seen.
He was about the best. It kind of makes you a little, you know, teary.
We know how you feel. I'm Nancy Mathis, Channel 9 Eyewitness News.
Expressions of grief have been pouring into Channel 9 all day, by telephone, by telegram, and by fax. Dave Statter reports.
Eyewitness News.
Eyewitness News.
Hello, News.
When a TV station gets more than 300 calls over 6 hours on just one topic, it is usually because we've done something wrong. The calls today came because Glenn Brenner did everything so right.
Good looking set.
It's your favorite set.
Marconi gave us this one.
Be careful with that.
Oh!
Excuse me, officer.
How you doing, sir?
Fine, how you doing? I mean, what's the charge?
Oh, you got an overlarge
weenie?
Weenie on the street, sir.
My weenie's too big?
Too big.
An oversized weenie.
Oversized weenie.
I'm gonna fight this in court.
All the information's on the back, sir.
All right, thank you very much, officer.
Thank you.
Good morning, WUSA.
Cheryl Greer has talked to most of you who called today.
It's really heartwarming that he has so many friends out there.
How are you holding up taking all these calls?
It's rough. It really is. It's sad in my heart.
It hasn't been just phone calls. There have been faxes and telegrams. Here are some of the thoughts you have shared with us about Glenn. Andrea Beach of Riverdale. The whole city is talking about it. I just need to laugh with him again. He made us laugh at ourselves and each other, and he had the rare ability to laugh at himself. Irene of Fairfax. I feel as though I lost a good friend. I don't understand a lot about sports, but you didn't need to when you watched Glenn. Nimi Bergen of Burke, I don't think you'll ever find another personality like his. He always looked on the bright side. Julie of the DC Parking Enforcement Branch, he meant everything here. He was the best. No one else could touch him. Steve Scarborough of Columbia, Glenn was the best I ever saw. Mr. Scarborough, he was the best we ever saw, too.
It all started the first week of the season when reliever Tommy Green Hello? We don't have the Tommy Green tape? We don't have that. Okay. Well, light him up if you got him.
Dave Statter, Channel 9, Eyewitness News.
We'll be back with more in a moment.
Have you met my bodyguard?
I don't want to shout this.
What?
Maureen get a haircut? Huh? Is that supposed to be humor?
She asked him to help a boy.
Good evening, I'm Maureen Bunyan.
I'm Gordon Peterson. It is our painful duty to tell you, Maureen and mine, that our friend and colleague Glenn Brenner passed away at 7:58 this morning at George Washington University Medical Center. Glenn's wife, Susie, and his mother, Edie Brenner, were with him at the time of his death. Glenn fell ill on November 3rd, immediately after finishing his second Marine Corps marathon. After initial signs of recovery, his condition began to deteriorate. That was last month. On Saturday, doctors discovered that he had an inoperable malignant brain tumor. Glenn's immediate survivors include his children, Amy, Ashley, Matt, and his mother and father, Edie and Bill Brenner of Philadelphia. Channel 9's president and general manager, Hank Yagi, speaks for all of us when he says, "We are deeply saddened by Glenn's passing, and our hearts and prayers are with his family at this trying time."
Glenn was 44 years old. He brought an irreverent joy and wit to his work. He was the genuine article. What you saw on the air is what you got when the cameras were turned off, too. In short, Glenn was a natural. He was the best. Glenn Brenner was born in Philadelphia in 1948. Humor came easily to him right from the start, as you can see. He also spent a lot of time playing ball. Glenn once said he and his Philly neighborhood friends used to play sports all day long. And it was in baseball, not television, that Glenn started his career. Right out of high school, he signed a professional contract with the Mets and later returned to his hometown Phillies. But after 6 years, his arm gave out.
If I could have gotten the ball over the plate, you know, you'd be talking to an empty chair right now. But I always had problems with control. I mean, everybody knew I had problems with control. So this one particular night, it happened a lot, but it used to drive me crazy. You'd walk two guys. You see the manager, time, call time, walk out to the mound. He'd say, "Glenn, come on, throw strikes." He'd say, "Oh, why didn't you say something earlier? I wouldn't have done this if I, you should have told me you wanted me to throw strikes." You know, so, of course I'm trying to throw strikes, you jerk, get out of here, you know.
Lucky for us, he stepped off the pitching mound he loved and moved into broadcasting. He started at a tiny radio station in Millville, New Jersey, then spent a few years back home at WFIL Radio in Philadelphia. But it wasn't until Glenn switched to television that his great talent was noticed. He spent his rookie year in TV as a sports reporter in Huntington, West Virginia. After just 1 year, Philadelphia's KYW-TV hired him away. And just 1 year later, in 1977, Glenn joined us here at Channel 9. Glenn's work in the sports department has been awarded again and again. He was especially proud of several Emmy Awards he won and did not hesitate to tell us about it.
More coffee, Mr. Brenner?
No, thanks, Gene. Now, that'll be all. Just take the check, please.
That'll be $4.35.
Okay, thank you. Could you just hold this for a second, please? Thank you.
Park here. This is the general manager spot.
Not anymore, Polly.
WUSA Sports, home of Glenn Brenner, the Emmy Award-winning sportscaster. Can I help you?
Morning, little people.
It was a privilege to have worked with Glenn. He was a talented professional. He was innovative and dedicated. But more than anything else, Glenn could make us laugh. He made us laugh like no one else could.
Room, coffee. What? What a concept. Coffee actually in your room. Why didn't I think of that?
Got Maureen's teddy bear today. Where'd you get this?
Northern Virginia Community College and Alex.
Follow me. Let's see if the little guy can swim. Look out!
I told them you were a wonderful
Not a big
person.
Splash either, right by the 14th Street Bridge. He's all right. He's paddling towards shore right there. Anyway, hey, just kidding.
Coming up on Eyewitness News, Maryland police are on the lookout for an extremely dangerous nun. Man, I mean, who's wanted for kidnapping and shooting.
Do you have any trouble getting in today? I was like 15 or 20 minutes late. I found this roadblocks down on River Road. And I asked the officer, I said, you know, what's the type? He said, well, we're on the lookout for an extremely dangerous nun. And I didn't know. Apparently, she goes around shopping centers grabbing people by the ear, random, and, like, pulling them, and then makes them stay after school. And I mean, it's unbelievable. She's now, you know, I'll blow it now after that. Anyway, wow, be on the lookout. Sister Kunaguna. Anyway, last night, the murder.
Even when things didn't go right, Glenn salvaged them, sometimes made the show even better with his quick wit.
Some sort of nervous breakdown. It all started the first week of the season when reliever Tommy Green, hello, we don't have the Tommy Green tape? We don't have that. Okay. Well, light him up if you got him. Anyway,
Smoking lab flit.
What tape do you want to run? Why don't you run something and I'll talk about that. Let's see what you got there. There's Tommy Green. Attaboy. There's Tommy over in the mezzanine section. Then last week, Jason Grimsley nearly made modern Major League Baseball history. And Jason Grimsley nearly made modern League Major League history. Hello? Earth to the control room. Come
it's
in, please.
Yeah.
And Glenn made it all look easy. The viewers never saw that part of him that labored over every story, struggled to find the right word to say, just the right question to ask, and to make each and every show one to remember.
Coming back to it, the easy thing for you to do is call press conference the next day and say, we've talked to the guys, and it's not going to happen again, and you'd rather eat a bug than do that.
Exactly right. That is exactly right. Because I think it's hypocritical. I don't think, if I go to you...
Is it hypocritical or is it just, it's the competitor? It's the orneriness. You're not going to give him the satisfaction?
It's a little bit of both.
Glenn had style. He brought something to sportscasting that no one else had. Shows that appealed to everyone, not just sports fans. He knew what people liked. It was Glenn's enormous creativity that gave us Weenie of the Week, Encore Wednesday, and Mystery Prognosticator, to name a few.
Right, now here's one I think I know you're going to pick. The New Orleans Saints at New England.
Now you say that just because they're Saints.
That's right.
Sometimes I don't go along with the Saints. They fool you. Okay?
All right, who do you like in that one?
I think the New Orleans will be.
So you like the Saints?
Yeah.
Okay. The Giants?
Oh, I didn't say I like the Saints.
Giants. I'm talking to a group of people who are not that interested in what I have to say. Statistically, they've proven that. So what I want to do is keep their interest. And the way I can best do that is to relate to them. There's nothing I can think of that attracts me like broadcasting does. You know, I just really feel I was cut out to do this.
I didn't know the man, but I just got the feeling that I knew him. I enjoyed him. He made you feel good when you watched him. And we all feel lost. It just is a friend is gone, even though I didn't know him.
Funeral arrangements for Glenn Brenner are incomplete at this hour. The news of Glenn Brenner's death has brought an outpouring of love and grief throughout the Washington area. From the city's power elite to the sports fan on the street, Glenn's passing has touched many people. Channel 9's Chris Gordon reports.
I think I'm going to always remember Glenn for just throwing his hands up in the air and saying, hey, that's sports. Sean, hi, how are you?
A couple memories there. I guess the biggest thing I remember about him is bringing laughter into my home. And I think if all of us, you know, can laugh a little bit more, the world might be a little bit better.
The phone lines at WMAL Radio were filled for hours with listeners calling with their stories about Glenn.
The call started to come in dribs and drabs when I mentioned it, and then all of a sudden it's like the floodgates got let loose, because we're talking here about a touchstone. You know, somebody who you look to and you say, oh, cool, everything's all right because Glenn Brenner's on the air, you know, and there's something a little bit wrong with Washington today.
Redskins owner Jack Kent Cook had a special relationship with Glenn, professionally as a journalist who interviewed him often, and personally as a friend Cook invited to his home.
I speak with a little emotion. I'm going to miss him terribly. He made life just a little happier for me, and I know that he made it a little more comfortable for almost everybody that he ever met. He truly was one of a kind. That mold is broken. God bless you, Glenn Brenner.
Glenn's next-door neighbor was banker Bob Pincus, who has for years tried to bring baseball back to Washington.
Glenn did interview me on the deck of my house. He and I went to the sports from my swimming pool in my living room, and most of the interviews were centered around baseball, and Glenn really had a passion to bring baseball back to Washington. And one of my last things I said to Glenn on Saturday night was, Glenn, if you hear me, I am not going to disappoint you. We will bring baseball back to Washington, because I knew how important it was both to him and to the community.
Perhaps no one understood what Glenn was going through more than former White House Press Secretary James Brady, who had the same doctor and visited Glenn in the hospital at Thanksgiving time.
And as one would expect, he was holding court in the hall, people all around him, and he was enjoying it, you could tell. And Art Cobreen was there. And the one
class... Your good friend, Dr. Cobreen.
And my physician, Dr. Cobreen. The one question Glenn had for me is, how do you make the time pass in here? You could tell that he was just churning to get out of there and to get back at doing what he did best.
Maury Siegel was one of Washington's first TV sportscasters. He worked here at Channel 9 and has been everywhere since.
If Glenn wasn't the original, he was certainly unique, and I think he had the absolute perfect approach to sports in Washington, where our sports are not so hot. Glenn, I regarded as a sort of Henny Youngman of sports announcers, a sort of a funny guy who wrapped himself around a few baseball and football scores, and thank God he wasn't one of those three runs, four hits, one error. He had a great sense of humor. He had a great impact on this town, and I am terribly saddened over Glenn's death and express my heartfelt sympathies to the Brenner family, to Channel 9, and to the millions of viewers that love Brenner.
When Glenn was offered the job to replace Warner Wolf, who left for New York, he declined, saying, I'll replace the guy who replaces Warner Wolf. And Glenn did.
The first time I ever saw Glenn was about 1976. He was doing a week in sports in Philadelphia, and he was great. And I said, man, this guy's terrific. He's going to go a long way. One of the secrets Glenn had was, besides knowing the sports and making you laugh, he was very sensitive. You could see that he was a very sensitive person. I know why Washington loved him. And being a Washingtonian myself, I can say that we're not going to forget you, Glenn.
None of us will. Chris Gordon, Channel 9 Eyewitness News.
The White House issued a statement from President Bush today expressing sadness over Glenn's passing. The president called Glenn a man whose wit and ability has endeared him to so many Washingtonians and whose death has left all of us with a painful emptiness. The president says he and his wife Barbara will remember Glenn as a man who loved his work, his family, and the community he served, qualities that made him so special.
If you would like to make a donation in Glenn's memory, his family requests that those donations go to Glenn's favorite charities. They include the Children's Inn at NIH at 7 West Drive in Bethesda, Maryland. Donations can also be made to the Children's Hospital National Medical Center on Michigan Avenue in Northwest. And donations can also be made in Glenn's name to Best Buddies of America, Incorporated on New York Avenue in Northwest Washington. If you would like to send your personal condolences to Glenn's family, you may do so in care of WUSA-TV, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue, Northwest. We'll repeat these addresses again later in our broadcast.
When we come back, we'll have the rest of the day's news.
That's the wrong tape. Guys, get my Uzi. I'm going up to the control room. I'll be right back.
They played the wrong tape.
Do they have the right tape? They do have the right tape? Ask them if they'd like to play that now. Would they like to play that?
I think disadvantaged, sir, because you don't have the opportunity to handicap what happened the week before, yeah. So... You've got to go from the preseason, based on the preseason and your instincts in this particular case, which I think are pretty good. All right, let's start with Denver at Los Angeles. Who do you like in that one?
I like Denver. Is it? You sure it's at Los Angeles?
We got an hour. We don't have an hour?
What?
It's been a meltdown. That's all. Running for your life. What's going on?
You don't get me back now.
Sonny, so... No. Come on, buddy, let's talk. We never talk anymore. Let's talk.
Get out of here.
We got about 5 minutes.
What? We're going to try it again? Let's go. Try number three. It's the hat trick. Here we go. Good luck.
This is a lot of fun.
We're not trying it. We are trying it.
subject of baseball, believe it or not.
Boston Red Sox third baseman Wade Boggs has come out with his own candy bar. It's called the Wade Boggs 352 bar. That's Wade on the cover. It's about the size and shape of a Kit Kat bar. It's all chocolate, no nuts or raisins. And Wade, as you know, has won five American League batting titles. I don't know if the Wade Boggs bar will improve your average at the plate, but I had one for lunch today, and it will definitely make a difference in the newsroom.
Just a little bit.
Thank you.
The first game this week is Atlanta at San Francisco. Who do you like in this one? Who do you like in this game? Who do you like in this one, sweetie? I think she likes Atlanta in that game. All right. Thank you very much. Atlanta in that one. All right, let's move down here. I don't know if you're a Redskin fan or not. We got Dallas at Washington this week. Who do you like in this one? Oh, she's going with the Redskins. Going with the Redskins. Good call. Good call. Get you a lot of fans.
For charities in his memory. Cindy DiBiase has more on the charities designated by the Brenner family.
The three charities the Brenner family has chosen have one thing in common. They all work towards improving or saving children's lives. No one knows that better than Paula Fletcher. Today, her 8-month-old daughter Meredith came off a heart monitor at Children's Hospital. Meredith and twin sister Suzanne were born 3 months prematurely. They spent 2 months in a hospital on respirators, in danger of dying.
It saved the lives of our children. Not only the monitors themselves and the technical support, but the fact that I can call these people anytime, day or night, with a question, and they have just educated me and my husband so much. It just means the world to us.
Every year, Glenn broadcasts Redskins sidelines from the hospital, giving the kids a chance to visit with the player and be on television. Another Brenner favorite, Children's Inn at the National Institutes of Health, where out-of-town families stay while their children get treated at NIH for everything from cancer to AIDS. For families like the Hayes from Southern Virginia, the inn provides refuge as they wait to find out whether 7-year-old Robert's bone tumor is malignant.
I have to get it cut open.
Does that scare you?
Yeah.
A third Brenner charity, Best Buddies. It serves mentally retarded people age 8 to 80. The organization matches up mild to moderately retarded people with college students. They spend time together and learn from each other. What do you like best about what you've done so far?
Well, I like hanging out with my buddy.
The confidence factor, honest to God, is the most blatant thing that I see. On both sides, but especially for those who are retarded. I think it makes them really feel like, you know, I'm an important person and I am a valuable asset to the community.
It really is no surprise that Glenn was active in these three particular charities when you consider the type of work they do and their philosophies. Let me read to you the credo from one of them, Best Buddies. What is a friend? A person with whom you dare to be yourself. You can weep with him, sin with him, laugh with him, pray with him. Through it all and underneath, he sees, knows, and loves you.
Thank you, Cindy. As Cindy said, if you'd like to make a donation in Glenn's memory, his family asks that the donations go to those three charities, the Children's Inn at 7 West Drive in Bethesda, Maryland, also the Children's Hospital National Medical Center on Michigan Avenue in Northwest Washington. And you can also make a donation in Glenn's name to Best Buddies of America, Incorporated, 1350 New York Avenue, Northwest Washington. If you'd like to send your condolences to Glenn's family, you may do so in care of WUSA-TV, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue, Northwest. We'll repeat the addresses again later in our newscast.
And coming up on Eyewitness News, local sports figures remember Glenn Brennan. Stay with us.
Yeah. Oh, that's a strange way of arriving.
All right, Captain, Atlanta at New Orleans.
Atlanta at New Orleans. New Orleans is doing great. They'll win.
All right, you like the Saints. Detroit at Green Bay.
Detroit at Green Bay. Now, Detroit is got, they've got that wonderful quarterback, but...
It's tough go. You know, everyone who ever worked for, with, or around Glenn Brenner, virtually anyone who had any contact with the man remembers him today. Here are more of Glenn's friends.
Well, I personally think that probably the funniest guy I've ever been around. And I think he was just a natural wit that would make you laugh if we were talking like we are right now. It didn't make any difference whether he was on camera. I think, you know, what you saw on TV was, that was Glenn. And he was just a fun guy to be around. And, you know, even though we at Redskin Park are very happy with our situation, this is definitely a downer for us to lose not only, you know, a great sportscaster, but also a great friend. I think it's one of the toughest things that has ever hit me, really.
As far as colleague, Glenn was the kind of guy that no matter where we were, and the first thing that comes to my mind is Super Bowl 17 out in California when our transmitter blew over, and he said, I'd lend you mine, he said, but I want all the viewers. We had a wonderful, competitive relationship that I don't think most folks could ever understand. Glenn, no matter what it was, he always made you laugh.
But he told this story for 15 minutes, and I laughed, and the tears started to go down my cheeks, and then my stomach muscles started to cramp. I'm in agony with my stomach muscles. I'm laughing, and the tears are pouring down my face. I'm trying to stand up to stop the pain, and he keeps telling this story. And today, you can go to those 15 people who were at the table last night, and all you got to do is say Glenn Brenner and the Chihuahua story, and they'll smile. I guarantee it. This is the saddest thing that I've ever seen.
I met him at a Bullets game. I came up for a Bullets game, and he was there, and of course I knew who he was, and I went right up to the press table and introduced myself. And what impressed me about him so much was the fact that at the end of the game, when I went in the locker room, as I was walking out, he was walking by, and I said, see you, Glenn, and he said, see you, Steve. And I thought to myself, God, the guy remembered my name.
I'll just remember him for the way he always had of making people laugh, no matter how tough the news was that day or how tough a day you had. If you turned on Glenn for sports, it usually felt good before you went to bed. So I think he really helped a lot of people in the time that he did have here.
I can think of the time that James Brown and I were about to tape our first edition of Fast Break. This was about 7 or 8 years ago. It was going to air on Channel 9. And, of course, we were a little nervous, particularly myself. And Glenn said, hey, Coach, just relax. There's only going to be about 300,000 people watching you. And he got us laughing so hard, as only Glenn could do, we went in and did pretty well.
He could relate to you. If you wanted to joke with him, like I said, he would joke with you. If you wanted to be serious, he could be serious. You know, I'm kind of lost for words, actually, because it really hadn't sunk in yet to lose somebody like Glenn. You know, I'll miss him. I'll definitely miss him.
It was an emotional game. It was for a lot of people because it was a big game and all the emotions of the game. But I know that when I turned and all of a sudden that locker room, I know it dawned on me that there were a lot of people in there. Tears in their eyes were not from an emotional football win, but was looking at a possible loss of a great friend. And so as I saw that happen, I knew it was a tremendous emotional point for everybody.
If it happened, it must have happened for the good, because I can't see anything happening for the bad when Glenn Brenner is concerned. It was just his time to go, and, you know, he's up there with a good man now. He's looking down upon us, and he's probably cracking the joke right now. And we're going to miss you, Glenn.
He said, we're going to play golf, you and I, but this is the first time I've ever kissed my golf partner, because I don't do that when I play golf.
Was it a good kiss?
It was a good one. One that I won't forget.
Glenn Brenner left us today. I need not tell you how he brightened this very set, how he brought this program alive, how by the sheer force of his personality he transformed mundane facts and foibles into truly fascinating tales, vignettes, and one-liners. God gave us all unique talents and valid and varied approaches to life and our work, but Glenn was one of a kind. Describing his style requires a couple of hyphens. Glenn Brenner was the world's best sports-oriented entertainer reporter. He had the ability to see beyond the statistics and scores to the human element of an event, absurd or profound. His eye would catch any deviation from the norm, and his wit would raise it to a happening unto itself, be it a tennis tirade, a baseball rally cap, or a water-skiing squirrel. His humor was often impish, devilish. A couple of summers ago, we hosted a little backyard party. We were just sitting around a table chatting about sports, television, the kids, when suddenly Glenn got up and fully clothed, jumped into the swimming pool. "I've always wanted to do that," was his explanation. And when the party was over, his dripping clothes were draped over the railing of our deck, and Glenn drove home in the only dry stuff he had left, his bathing suit. That was Brenner. Glenn was a mercurial character. When he was angry, you knew it. When he was sad, you knew why. When he was happy, it just simply bubbled over. He was a powerful presence. When he walked into a room, it just seemed to move toward him. And you certainly knew he was there. Glenn's passing is proof that it's not a fair or perfect world. But one thing is sure. If Glenn finds that heaven has some characters that need some dressing down, there's soon going to be a great Weenie Academy in the sky. And the angels will certainly know that he's there. Peace and love, Glenn.
I'll be right back.
Sorry.
Don't be sorry, pal. Don't be sorry. In his 14-plus years, Glenn Brenner provided us with a lifetime of memories, so we'll have a look back at those memories when we come back.
Gentlemen, now why do we want baseball in Washington?
Because baseball is, because it brings entertainment and fun to the entire community.
I say because families can enjoy it and they can afford it, too.
Well, you gotta remember, it offers a financial shot in the arm to our local economy.
Plus, we'll probably get free tickets.
Now what?
Oh, I'm sorry, that's not my line.
I think being seen with us can't hurt you politically.
Is it important? Hey, don't forget, it offers a financial shot in the arm to our local economy.
I want a baseball team so young people can see their role models and heroes go to prison.
Don't forget, it's going to be a financial shot in the arm to the community.
The what?
Yes. I wanted to say
the community. Okay. We want baseball in the community.
Please, no matter what Brenner says, don't laugh or we'll be out here all day. Okay, hey, I got the six off. I don't care. Okay.
Glenn Brenner came to work here in 1977, and the place has never been the same since, and neither have I. I have to tell you that I once had some aspirations towards serious broadcast journalism. They all went out the window the day Brenner walked in the door.
This is a Red Byrne from Redskins Park for Eyewitness Sports.
Okay, what's the bottom line on this now?
I just think that they have to win. They have to win tomorrow, all right?
The man who brought me to Washington, Jim Snyder, hired Brenner out of KYW Philadelphia. He didn't billboard him as anything special, just some guy who was going to do sports. After our first time together on the air, I walked into Snyder's office and I said, "You've got yourself a winner." Why was Glenn Brenner a winner? In my case, he tapped a wellspring of goofiness I had managed to keep hidden for years.
Guy Lagie is here.
Guy Lagie.
New winger.
Guy Lagie!
Don't be afraid to ask me a question because I won't be very direct with you.
Okay.
Anything you got to say, boom, I'm
okay.
Ready.
Gee, I wanted to ask you about the guy.
About anything, just ask me. Just come right out, you know.
Well, Gee, I wanted
I've
to ask
always
you.
Believed you're very, you know.
Well, you Canadians are like that, Gee.
There was no situation, no moment, however, embarrassing that was safe from Brenner's deadly wit. Nothing and no one was sacred, especially not himself.
Not funny. It's not funny. And it's one of those shows anyway. I can hear all the calls now. Unprofessional. That's what you are. Today,
Mo Siegel says Glenn Brenner was a comedian wrapped around a few baseball stories. He was that, I guess, but he was a lot more than that too.
He was my mentor. He was my hero, and he was my friend.
He's the kind of guy you could take him in any neighborhood in this city. And the kids would run over me to get to him.
Now, here are a few thoughts of my own about Glenn. He was the funniest man I've ever known, of course. He was one of the most serious men I've ever known. He took his work seriously. Nobody ever worked harder. Ask the grunts who worked for him. I try to teach them always to do their best, he told me. And they were at his bedside last night, his guys, telling Brenner stories nonstop. Some you would have to keep from your grandmother. He took his writing seriously, and he wrote well. He was the quickest tongue in the West. Nobody was ever faster off the mark with an ad lib, but he took a lot of time in his copy and he gave it a great deal of thought. He took his family seriously. He was forever quoting his magnificent wife, Susie, and his magnificent parents, Bill and Edie.
and he spent time staring at the ceiling every night, wondering what the future holds for his children, Amy, Ashley, and Matt. Not to worry, Toots, not to worry. He took his life seriously. Over the past several months, we'd had some good talks, some great talks, and my God, was he honest. I mean, honest with himself, about everything. Glenn Brenner had a built-in BS detector that would go off at 1,000 yards. And by the way, he would have hated all the fuss we're making over him right now. Like hell, he would have loved it. But I want to tell you the truth about his final days. He suffered. The doctors told us he was getting better. He knew that he was not. From day one, he told us he had a brain tumor. We told him he was just depressed. If he had a tumor, we said, the doctors would have caught it. We were wrong. He was right. At the end, he was so sick, he didn't want to see anyone. We asked him to open up his life to his friends, to let the healing power of love wash over him. And God love his great courage, he did it. Yesterday afternoon, as he lay dying at GW, his buddy, the football nun from Visitation, Sister Marie Louise, slipped out of her cloistered world to come and see him. "Hey, Glenn," we said, "Wheezy's here." For the first time that day, he opened one eye and he gave her a wave. He gave her a wave. Well, that's the way I'm going to remember you, pal, winking at an old nun on your deathbed, giving her a wave. Happy trails. Love, Sparky. Colleague passed away at 7:58 this morning at George Washington University Medical Center. Glenn's wife Susie and his mother Edie Brenner were with him at the time of his death. Glenn fell ill on November 3rd, immediately after finishing his second Marine Corps marathon. After initial signs of recovery, his condition began to deteriorate last month. On Saturday, doctors discovered that he had an inoperable malignant brain tumor. Glenn's immediate survivors include his children, Amy, Ashley, Matt, and his mother and father, Edie and Bill Brenner of Philadelphia. Channel 9's president and general manager, Hank Yagi, speaks for us when he says, "We are deeply saddened by Glenn's passing, and our hearts and prayers are with his family at this trying time." Glenn Brenner was 44.
Glenn Brenner was a sportscaster who knew his trade. He was also an entertainer who could be outlandish and disarming at the same time. He had wit and timing and a dedication to be great at what he did. He carried that same sense of humor and dedication to every aspect of his life. He was simply the same person on screen as he was off screen. With Glenn, what you saw was what you got. Glenn Brenner was born in Philadelphia in 1948.
I thought I'd hate watching that again, but I love it. The news of Glenn Brenner's passing spread quickly today and was followed by an outpouring of sadness. From the corridors of power to the sidewalks of the city, people shared their grief over the loss of a man who had become one of the family. The White House issued a statement expressing President and Mrs. Bush's painful emptiness over the suddenness of Glenn's death. The president called Glenn a man whose wit and ability had endeared him to many, someone who loved his work, his family, and the community he served. There were many others who expressed their feelings on this day. Chris Gordon talked to some of them.
Ripken goes right. Redskins, by the way, are dedicating this NFC Championship game to one of America's great sportscasters, Glenn Brenner.
A dedicated game ball to Glenn Brenner.
This picture hangs on a wall at Redskin Park. Glenn interviewing team owner Jack Ken Cook, with whom he had not only a professional relationship, but a personal friendship as well.
I wanted that game to be dedicated to him, and I'm so glad I did. I speak with a little emotion. I'm going to miss him terribly. He made life just a little happier for me, and I know that he made it a little more comfortable for almost everybody that he ever met. He truly was one of a kind. That mold is broken. God bless you, Glenn Brenner.
Glenn's next-door neighbor was banker Bob Pincus, who led the effort to win a National League expansion team franchise for our city.
Glenn really had a passion to bring baseball back to Washington, and one of my last things I said to Glenn on Saturday night was, Glenn, if you hear me, I am not going to disappoint you. We will bring baseball back to Washington, because I knew how important it was both to him and to the community.
Perhaps no.
I can't believe he gets away with that.
Excuse me, officer.
How you doing, sir?
Fine, how you doing? I mean, what's the charge?
Well, you got an overlarge
weenie?
Weenie on the street, sir.
My weenie's too big?
Too big.
An oversized weenie.
Oversized weenie.
Well, a lot of times we said the same thing, and we were always glad he did.
I got my glasses today. I decided to go with him. Just tell me honestly. I mean, don't spare my feelings. Tell me what camera's it, too. You good. How do you think they look? What do you think?
Glenn was the kid in class who terrorized the teacher and still managed to end up her pet.
Did I tell you guys about my speaking fee, by the way?
Yeah.
Did your teacher mention that it's $500?
No.
So do you have any lunch money left? Do you have any,
Yeah.
How much lunch money? How much money you got on you? Let me give you a little advice on homework. You'll do what I do. Yeah. Skip it. Come in. Steal somebody else's, turn that in.
Did you ever get any F's on your report card?
Did I ever get any F's on my report card? Well, let me ask you guys that question. Do I look like a guy who would get F's on his report card?
Yeah.
Good judges of character.
He never completely grew up. Dressing for work meant putting on a coat and tie and sweatpants.
I mean, you know, I wasn't really like a big sports...
This sports section about me winning the Sportscaster of the Year award. If you didn't, I'll be happy to send you a copy. When you win something like that, people automatically think it's going to change you. But I can assure you, it was business as usual at the office today. Bernie, babe, listen to me, babe. I don't care who you get to play me. Richard Gere, Ted Danson, that's fine, babe, okay? I got no problem with that.
It wasn't I wanted to work in sports, and it wasn't I wanted to work in TV sports. I wanted to work for Glenn Brenner.
Glenn had a favorite routine he liked to pull on me about 10 o'clock every night. That was my deadline time. I'd be sitting here writing my story on the computer, and he'd sneak up behind me, and he had always this big white T-shirt on, and he'd pull his shirt over my head. I'd go, Glenn, I'm on deadline, will ya? And he goes, lighten up. And he'd walk off, and he'd laugh, and what a knucklehead. Glenn learned to compete on a ball field. The guys who worked against him knew that Glenn kept them at the top of their game.
I don't think it's easy to do this job for anybody, but if anybody had seemed effortless in the way they did it, it was Glenn, just because he had the natural ability to communicate with people, as natural as anybody I've ever seen.
We who were lucky enough to see him delighted in his antics. I don't think we'll ever see another one like him in our lifetime.
I envied him because he always saw the best in people and things and the joy and the humor in life. I wish I was more like him.
The measure of any man's wealth is to be determined by how much he is loved. And I assure you, there is no wealthier man going to heaven than Glenn Brenner.
Channel 7's Dale Solly knew Glenn for 17 years. They had started out in the business together, and they made a pact to run the Marine Corps Marathon 2 years ago.
His kids are Amy, Ashley, and Matt. And to them, Glenn was the best father that I ever saw.
He was also the best friend you could ever want.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is the class of 83. These 16 men ran up the highest hotel bill in the history of Western civilization.
Nancy Mathis, Channel 9, Eyewitness News.
You know, I think they charged that bill to George Michael, if I'm not mistaken, over Channel 4. Anyway. Much of his brilliance stemmed from his ability to look beyond the scores and the games to make his sportscast entertaining to all, or almost all. Ken Meese is here with a reaction from some of the people on whom Glenn reported.
Did
Ken,
George ever pay the bill?
I'm kind of touchy subject.
Well, indeed, the sports and media world continue to pay their tributes to Glenn throughout the day and tonight. At the Capitol Center, the Bullets.
We'd like to ask you to join the Bullets organization now for a moment of silence for a dear member of our sports family who passed away earlier this morning, Glenn Brenner. Glenn was a sports institution in our community for 15 years. His wit, his friendship, and his dedication to area sports fans will be sorely missed. Our prayers and thoughts go out to Glenn's wife, Susie, his children, Amy, Ashley, and Matthew, and of course to his family at Channel 9. We'll miss you, Glenn.
in St. Louis, the Capitals telecast.
A very special game for the Washington Capitals. They are dedicating this game to the memory of Glenn Brenner, a longtime Channel 9 sportscaster who passed away suddenly this morning back in Washington, D.C.
The nation shared our grief through ESPN's SportsCenter.
But his quick wit made him a natural for our business. He began in radio, moved over to television. Brenner eventually became the most popular TV sportscaster in Washington.
His friends and colleagues remembered.
I'll just remember him for the way he always had of making people laugh. No matter how tough the news was that day or how tough a day you had, if you turned on Glenn for sports, it usually felt good before you went to bed. So I think he really helped a lot of people in the time that he did have here.
If it happened, it must have happened for the good, because I can't see anything happening for the bad when Glenn Brenner is concerned. It was just his time to go, and, you know, he's up there with a good man now. He's looking down upon us, and he's probably cracking the joke right now.
I met him at a Bullets game. I came up for a Bullets game, and he was there, and of course I knew who he was, and I went right up to the press table and introduced myself. And what impressed me about him so much was the fact that at the end of the game, when I went in the locker room, as I was walking out, he was walking by, and I said, "See you, Glenn," and he said, "See you, Steve." And I thought to myself, God, the guy remembered my name.
The fun that was the NFL Mystery Prognosticator series provided an unlikely champion, and Glenn with one of the most profound friendships of his life, the indomitable Sister Marie Louise.
He said, "I never, we're going to play golf, you and I, but this is the first time I've ever kissed my golf partner, because I don't do that when I play golf."
Was it a good kiss?
It was a good one. One that I won't forget.
And we won't forget Glenn Brenner, a totally unique talent. He's established a tradition of excellence here that we'll be hard-pressed to live up to. And next to the word individual in the dictionary is a picture of Glenn Brenner. Good night, sweet prince.
Gordon. We will continue in just a moment.
Earlier today, Mary Jo Fernandez, Radka Zubakova, and Pam Shriver. Thank you, Pam. All advanced with straight set victory. Shriver won 3 gold medals for the U.S. at the Pan Am Games. I think that was memorable. But for my money, the most memorable moment at the Pan Am Games, watching Cuban player Fidel Castro right here. Huh? He's actually doing the wave. Oh, he tires on it pretty quickly. To watch. They forget about it. Now I'm sitting down. It's getting old. Yeah, but that's legit.
Get out of here.
That's legit. That's he's doing the wave. Yeah, yeah.
Gentlemen, now why do we want baseball in Washington?
Because baseball is, because it brings entertainment and fun to the entire community.
I say because families can enjoy it and they can afford it, too.
Well, you gotta remember, it offers a financial shot in the arm to our local economy.
Plus, we'll probably get free tickets.
Now what?
Oh, I'm sorry, that's not my line.
I think being seen with us can't hurt you politically.
Is important. Hey, don't forget, it offers a financial shot in the arm to our local economy.
I want a baseball team so young people can see their role models and heroes go to prison.
Don't forget, it's going to be a financial shot in the arm to the community.
The what?
Yes. I wanted to say...
The community! Okay. We want baseball in the community!
Please, no matter what Brenner says, don't laugh or we'll be out here all day. Okay, hey, I got the 6 off. I don't care. Okay. Red Sox third baseman Wade Boggs has come out with his own candy bar. It's called the Wade Boggs 352 bar. That's Wade on the cover. It's about the size and shape of a Kit Kat bar. It's all chocolate, no nuts or raisins. And Wade, as you know, has won 5 American League batting titles. I don't know if the Wade Boggs bar will improve your average at the plate, but I had one for lunch today, and it will definitely make a difference in the newsroom.
WUSA Television, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue Northwest, Washington 20016. That's the Brenner family, care of WUSA TV, 4100 Wisconsin Avenue Northwest, Washington 20016. If you would like to make a donation in Glenn's memory, the family requests that your donations go to Glenn's favorite charities. Those charities are the Children's Inn at 7 West Drive in Bethesda, Maryland, the Children's Hospital National Medical Center on Michigan Avenue in Northwest Washington, and Best Buddies of America Incorporated on New York Avenue Northwest.
And now it's my turn. Glenn Brenner came to work here in 1977, and the place has never been the same since. Neither have I. I once had some aspirations towards serious broadcast journalism. They all went out the window the day Brenner walked in the door.
This is a Red Baron from Redskins Park for Eyewitness Sports.
Okay, what's the bottom line on this now?
I just think that they have to win. They have to win tomorrow, all right?
The man who brought me to Washington, Jim Snyder, hired Brenner out of KYW Philadelphia. He didn't billboard him as anything special, just some guy who was going to do sports. After our first time together on the air, I walked into Snyder's office and I said, "You've got yourself a winner." Why was Glenn Brenner a winner? In my case, he tapped a wellspring of goofiness I had managed to keep hidden for years.
Guy Lagui is here.
Guy Lagui.
New winger.
Guy Lagui. Guy.
Don't be afraid to ask me a question because I want to be very direct with you.
Okay.
Anything you got to say, boom, I'm
okay.
Ready.
Guy, I wanted to ask you
sure,
about the guy.
About the anything. Just ask me. Just come right out, you know.
Well, Guy, I wanted
I've
to
always
ask
believed you're very, you know.
Well, you Canadians are like that, Guy.
There was no situation, no moment, however, embarrassing that was safe from Brenner's deadly wit. Nothing and no one was sacred, especially not himself.
It's not funny. It's not funny. And it's one of those shows, anyway. I can hear all the calls now. Unprofessional, that's what you are. Today,
Mo Siegel says Glenn Brenner was a comedian wrapped around a few baseball stories. He was that, I guess, but he was a lot more than that, too.
He was my mentor, he was my hero, and he was my friend.
He's the kind of guy you could take him in any neighborhood in this city, and the kids would run over me to get to him.
Here are a few thoughts of my own about Glenn Brenner. He was the funniest man I've ever known, of course. He was one of the most serious men I've ever known. He took his work seriously. Nobody ever worked harder. Ask the grunts who worked for him. I try to teach them always to do their best, he told me. They were at his bedside last night, his guys, telling Brenner stories nonstop. Some of those stories you would have to keep from your grandmother. He took his writing seriously, and he wrote well. He was indeed the quickest tongue in the West. Nobody was ever faster off the mark with an ad lib, but he took a lot of time in his copy and he gave it a great deal of thought. He took his family seriously. He was forever quoting his magnificent wife, Susie, and his magnificent parents, Bill and Edie. And he spent some time staring at the ceiling at night, wondering what the future holds for his children, Amy, Ashley, and Matt. Not to worry, pal, not to worry. Glenn took his life seriously. Over the last several months, we'd had some good talks, some great talks, and my God, he was honest. I mean, he was honest with himself, about everything. And Glenn Brenner had a built-in BS detector that would go off at 1,000 yards. He would have hated all the fuss we're making over him right now. Like hell he would. But I want to tell you the truth about his final days. He suffered. He suffered. The doctors told us he was getting better. He knew that he was not. From the beginning, he told us he had a brain tumor. We told him he was just depressed. If he had a tumor, we said, the doctors would have caught it. We were wrong. He was right. At the end, he was so sick, he did not want to see anyone. We asked him to open up his life to his friends, to let the healing power of their love wash over him. And God love his great courage, he did it. Yesterday afternoon, as he lay dying at GW, his buddy, the football nun from Visitation, Sister Marie Louise, slipped out of her cloistered world to come and see him. "Hey, Glenn," we said, "Wheezy's here." For the first time that day, he opened one eye and gave her a wave. That's the way I'll remember you, pal. Winking at an old nun on your deathbed and giving her away. Giving her a wave. Happy trails, pal. Love, Sparky.
And sure, you're going to be instantly popular. That's no reason to do something impulsive. Think it over. The all-new Paseo. A very Practical Car from Toyota.
Definitely. Who's holding their breath for a new pizza? Contadina, really?
Glenn Brenner.
I just wanted to pass that along. Minute configuration. This is Glenn Brenner at RFK Stadium. Can you believe a man who calls himself a professional would wear a hat like that while out there in the field?
No.
No, I find it hard to believe myself.
Good evening. I'm Gordon Peterson.
And I'm Maureen Bunyan. We'd like to take one more opportunity to remember our friend and colleague, Glenn Brenner. For nearly 15 years, he sat in that chair next to us.
Now he's gone, but he left us with a lifetime of memories. In the next half hour, we'll share some of those memories. The best thing about Glenn, he always left us laughing.
For you, Ace. No way. Nice try.
No, he says he wants to talk to Mr. Sports.
Yeah, I hear you.
He says he would give anything to talk sports with the man.
It's what I've been telling you all along, Sparky. They have to watch you. They love to watch me. Yo.
Is this really you?
Yep.
Oh, golly. Wait till I tell my wife I talked to Sonny Jurgensen.
Time now to once again bring out the George Steinbrenner tote board. Whoa, if you're scoring at home with us, it's George's 19th managerial change in 17 years, dating back to 1973, when he... Please, care to join us if you like at home. When he hired Billy Verdon, fired Billy Verdon, hired Billy Martin, fired Billy Martin, hired Bob Lemon, fired Bob Lemon,
hired Billy Martin,
fired Billy Martin, hired Dick Houser, fired Dick Houser, hired Gene Michael, fired Gene Michael, hired Bob Lemon, fired Bob Lemon, hired Gene Michael, fired Gene Michael, hired Clyde King, fired Clyde King, hired Billy Martin, fired Billy Martin, hired Yogi Berra, fired Yogi Berra, hired Billy Martin, fired Billy Martin, hired Lou Piniella, fired Lou Piniella, hired, there's a definite pattern there, fired Billy Martin, hired Lou Piniella, fired Lou Piniella, hired Dallas Green, fired Dallas Green, hired Bucky Dent, fired Bucky Dent, and hired Stump Mitchell. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this. Oh, please, you're too kind. I feel like I'm back at the roast. Everybody's going,
do we have time to do this?
Hello, goodbye. Goodbye.
That's all.
Have a good night.
Glenn came to Channel 9 as a sportscaster in 1977, but as a kid in Philadelphia, he always dreamed of playing professional baseball. So how did he end up in television? Right out of high school, Glenn started pitching in the minor leagues for the Mets and the Phillies organizations. But after 6 years, his arm wouldn't perform, and he was faced with a career in the Mexican leagues. So he got out. He bluffed his way into a radio job in New Jersey, then went to Philly. Glenn broke into television at a station in Huntington, West Virginia. Then he returned again to work in Philly at KYW-TV. I remember Jim Snyder, Channel 9's news director at the time, told me he'd hired a new sportscaster, Glenn Brenner. I don't recall that Snyder said he was anything special, but it didn't take us long to find out that Glenn was very special.
Glenn was one of a kind. Mike Buchanan has a look back at what made Glenn so unique.
Good old acquaintance.
Take, for example, the Channel 9 crew at the Super Bowl in Pasadena back in the early 80s, Redskin-Miami game. There were about 20 of us. Brenner took us all to dinner, told us to order anything we wanted, and then charged it to George Michael's room.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is the class of 83. These 16 men ran up the highest hotel bill in the history of Western civilization.
I mean, the man had a natural talent for humor, and he worked hard to develop it into an art form.
So I want to introduce you to a new friend.
Let's see if the little guy can swim. Hi, over here. Whoa, there we go.
He took sports and made it what it should be, fun.
Not a big splash either, right by the 14th Street Bridge. He's all right. Before the regular season started, a lot of the so-called experts said that the Houston Oilers were a team that was headed for the Super Bowl. Well, for the first three periods today, the Oilers did appear headed for a bowl. Not the Super, more like the Tidy. I'm here to see Beach Blanket Bingo. I understand I was playing here tonight.
Haven't I seen you before?
I don't think so. I'm from the planet Remulac.
Glenn would grab every day and wring every ounce of life out of it. If you needed a lift during the day, you walk back into the sports department. We call it the toy department. Glenn was in charge. He handled technical difficulties with grace and dignity.
They played the wrong tape. What, do they have the right tape? They do have the right tape? Ask them if they'd like to play that now. Would they like to play that?
Have you met my bodyguard?
I don't want to shout this.
What?
Maureen, get a haircut?
He'd bust your chops at every opportunity.
This is a four phone book show, pal. You got
one. Oh, he's taking it out anyway.
Take, for example, a Notre Dame grad, Pat Collins, great Irish fan. And here comes Glenn.
Unranked San Francisco, 79. Fifth ranked Notre Dame, 70.
Chris Everett, it's Female Athlete of the Year. It's the third time she's won. The third time she's won the award in the last four seasons. Everett made over $100,000.
He laughed at his mistakes. Season.
And I know it's hard to believe, but a person can get tired of all that favorite sport. That international jet set life, you can get tired of it. I know I do. Veteran cowboy Gerald James is listed in stable condition tonight after getting accidentally stepped on by a 1,600-pound bull at the annual Calgary Stampede.
And his laugh was contagious.
Not funny. It's not funny. And it's one of those shows anyway. I can hear all the calls now. Unprofessional. That's what you are.
My ball, as you saw, came up a little short.
Glenn Brenner, integrity on the links.
It's just you and I out here right now, big fella. And Sonny's over at his ball, and Tim's over at his ball, and
I
got some bread right here. Just let me move that baby up on the grass. What do you think? Nobody's gonna know.
Yeah, I got a crazy bounce over here, guys. It caught the thing and then kicked back up. It kicked back up and see, it caught a lip right there. Wait, get a shot. Put his head down on my shoulder.
And then there was the Sonny and Glenn show.
Bruce, can you give me this over here? It's a gentleman from the construction site. He's hit about four of his employees. His Sonny has taken out about four employees this week. Believe me, just bill us for all the damages. WSA, care of Sonny Jurgensen. Today is Thursday, which of course means it's time now. Let's talk. Encore Wednesday.
Looks like I've got a tiger by the tail.
I apologize. Usually I get it back, but I could. Thanks, Mo. You get a big assist there, really.
What was it that triggered you?
I don't know. I think the total absurdity what I was doing.
Our loss is the entire community's loss. Everyone from the rich and famous to ordinary people are sharing our pain. Bruce Johnson talked to some people from around the region.
Look at this. He looks like an anchorman for SeaWorld, doesn't he? Where'd you get this? Real shy? Did he do that to you?
From Connecticut and Kay to Bethesda to Anacostia, they remembered Glenn Brenner as perhaps the funniest man ever to hit Washington TV.
Isn't that great? Handsome. Let me jump up in it. What were you thinking when you left the house this morning? This looks nice, huh? This'll work.
At the Bethesda Health Club, where Glenn often trained.
Everybody's totally devastated by it. I mean, the atmosphere here, it's hard for us to imagine what the club's going to be like without him here in the mornings.
At Bethesda Chevy Chase High School.
He was the only sports person that I would turn on and watch. I mean, I would look for him on Channel 9. Yeah. That's true.
He died this morning.
Oh, no, Glenn Brenner died.
Oh, that's sad.
That's sad. He was so good.
The bicycle messengers and the jobless in McPherson Square remember the sportscaster who could turn a serious moment into a laugh at the drop of a dime.
Mr. Shane. Yeah. He's a young man. Makes me think.
I like those
boys. Glenn Brenner, that was my man. There he was.
Yeah. Yeah.
Funny, too. He kept you laughing.
Yeah, I like it.
Vinnie Walters was one of Glenn's producers, and like others here, he was also a close family friend.
This business, there's pressure and stress, and everybody has it. He just made it all a little more bearable. He made it bearable. You were able to get through.
From the inner city to the outer suburbs, Glenn Brenner's death left viewers stunned and grasping for words.
Well, you used to hearing, Weenie of the Week and all the other stuff that he's. That's a rough one. Sorry to hear about it.
Well, it's a profound loss to this community. I mean, Glenn had such a great wit, such a great sense of humor. His Weenie of the Week, and he was really an inspiration to everybody.
When you have a sense of humor, it's a good sign
of an individual's inner feelings and personality.
Glenn Brenner used sports as a vehicle, but he could have done political commentary if he wanted. He was a well-read guy. He was a very spiritual person. A lot of people don't know that 2 months before the marathon, Glenn was seeking out close friends, and we were talking about things like spirituality and spiritual bankruptcy. And after you've gotten family and your job and other things lined up and you were in a groove and you still weren't happy, what did all that mean? He was in search of that inner peace, that kind of peace nobody else can give you, you know what I mean, that you have to reach down into your soul and get. And I can recall that I think it was a Saturday when I was on the floor in a heap just crying over the imminent loss of Glenn Brenner, and Gordon said to me, remember that 2 months ago he started on this spiritual journey. You know, Glenn's just going home and he's ready, you know, and he was ready. A lot of people don't get that opportunity to make things right before they leave.
Glenn was fortunate enough to have had a wonderful wife, Susie, and three wonderful children, Amy, Ashley, and Matt, terrific parents, Bill and Edie Brenner, and a best friend like no other best friend in Steve Dickstein. Their love was a source of strength to Glenn, and they always came first to him. But he had another family who also loved him, his family here at Channel 9. Here are some thoughts from the people who work beside Glenn every day.
Glenn used to pick on me an awful lot. Glenn picked on everybody, but I felt honored that he picked on me because you felt like he really liked you when he zapped you.
All through high school, when people asked me what I wanted to do, I said either I wanted to be a sportscaster or I wanted to work for Glenn Brenner.
Sorry, sir, can't come in.
Well, what do you mean I can't come in?
When the Academy's in session.
So I can't come in?
And it wasn't I wanted to work in sports, and it wasn't I wanted to work in TV sports. I wanted to work for Glenn Brenner.
A president could laugh at him. A cab driver could laugh at him. Perhaps we should say with him, because Glenn Brenner laughed at himself. He laughed himself. The humor was his. It was a shared experience with all of us.
He would censor jokes. I mean, this is he would appreciate the fact that there was a female in the office. And so he'd say, Grace, we're about to tell the punchline. You might want to step out. So I'd step out for all the punchlines. I always miss the punchline.
He had a nice, nice swagger about himself. And once he opened his mouth and started talking to you, he was like an everyday man. He would make you feel so good. He'd find something to kind of break the tension in the room, something to make you feel warm and accepted. He'd bust your chops.
James, as you see, is in the spirit now. He's got no tie. He's got a little cleavage showing over here. He's in Vegas.
No cleavage.
That's right. Anyway, the last official act before the fight was this morning, and that was the weigh-in. Both Marvin Hagler and Sugar Ray Leonard weighed in this morning at the Sports Pavilion, which is right behind us. We're at ringside here at Caesars Palace. Leonard was the first to arrive. Marvin showed up a few minutes later. As usual, they were both about a half hour late.
About the biggest things for me were Sugar Ray fights that we went to. All the times that Sugar Ray won, seems like every time he went, he won. And we'd act as if we were the ones that were the champions, because we'd hug each other and swing around and dance and then quiet down real quick when we got on the air and do our live stuff, and then we'd party again and smack each other around.
Even when he was so gravely ill this past weekend, here he is in bed snoring away, and there's a friend of his, Pat Butler, and there's his mom and dad and me in the room. And it's 12:30 in the morning, and in walks Joe Gibbs with the game ball, the game dedicated to Detroit, to Glenn Brenner. They beat the hell out of Detroit, and at 12:30 in the morning, here comes Joe Gibbs walking in the room. No entourage, no nothing, no flourish. And how special is Glenn? Joe Gibbs spent an hour in that room. He spent an hour in that room. And he talked to Glenn, and he talked to the parents, and he said what we all say, that he made them laugh.
You know, I'm sure you've seen or heard of Carnac, the mystic from the East. He appears on The Tonight Show occasionally, bears a striking resemblance to Johnny Carson. Mm-hmm. Carnac, of course, gives the answers to questions having never seen the question. Now, not many people do the act. Well, anyway, Carnac, believe it or not, watched today's Redskins game.
He
stopped
did.
By the office tonight, dropped this envelope off, asked me if I wouldn't read it on the air. Since he's an old friend, I thought, why not? The answer, okay?
Go ahead.
The answer, wives and footballs.
Wives and footballs.
That's right. Repeat that again. Wives and football. Not too much football. Time. All right. Can't get it out of the envelope. The question. Name two things Mickey Rooney and the St. Louis Cardinals can't hold on to.
When I first came here, I just said after one of Glenn's sportscasts, nice job. And he embraced me. He said, that's what I want to hear. I don't want to hear the truth. I want to hear exactly that kind of comment around here. Let me take you home and meet my wife, Susie, and my family. He didn't have any children at the time. I became like almost like a brother to him.
When he walked in, you wanted to say something to elicit a response. You knew he could come back with a line. You knew he could come up with the funny story or the shtick, and you wanted to see it. For just those few minutes, him walking through, you wanted Glenn Brenner.
Glenn, do you hear Philadelphia?
If you're Philadelphia, I hear Philadelphia.
Well, I would just watch Glenn when he would come in the newsroom and say, think to myself, uh-oh, what's coming now? What is he going to say now?
I hear Philadelphia.
What made Glenn so special was his unique ability to use the universal language of humor.
Glenn, do you hear Philadelphia?
Yes. Glenn, yeah, yes, I do. I hear Philadelphia.
You're saying he hears me? Hold your hand up if you hear me. He hears us. Okay. Thank you. Glenn, can you open Washington's mic?
I can't open my own mic, no.
Hey, come on, I can hear you.
Hi, Al. Can you hear me?
Oh, man. Way to go.
Yeah.
They finally solved the problem.
Yeah, they got people to the moon faster than this.
When Glenn walked into the office, it was exciting because it didn't matter how good your material was and how good the tape was that you'd been collecting all day, he could make it better.
The last time
brutal.
The Boston Red Sox won a World Series, this guy was in Pampers. Actually, it's been 72 years. They won the 1918, and then, after winning the series, they traded Babe Ruth.
There's no particular moment, necessarily, that stands out. I mean, there were so many jokes, so many moments, so many discussions of what to do, how to do things, how do you think we should approach this, this is how I want it to be approached. They all sort of meld together. So it's not a question of one joke or one vignette or one happenstance. It's just the total impact of the Glenn Brenner persona. Absolutely one of a kind.
He was my mentor, he was my hero, and he was my friend. Many times when you meet your heroes, they don't live up to your expectations. Glenn lived up to my expectations as a professional, and most importantly to me, as somebody who I would consider and could call my very close friend.
Glenn Brenner was an innovator. His Weenie of the Week, Encore Wednesday, and Mystery Prognosticator were staples of his sportscasts. And they were always a big hit with viewers, whether the viewers were sports fans or not. Perhaps none of them were as popular as the Weenie of the Week.
Leslie Banana was a fight trainer in New Orleans. Recently, one of his fighters, Joe McKnight, was taking on Jimmy Ellis Jr., the son of former heavyweight champion Jimmy Ellis. McKnight dropped Ellis several times in the first round. By the third round, Ellis claimed to have injured his knee. The fight was stopped. Then McKnight and Ellis exchanged words. And then this is where the fight is stopped. And then they resumed fighting. Ellis's manager, Doug Myers, tried to separate the two and was sucker punched by Bonanno, knocked out of the ring, where Bonanno jumped on him and started wailing again. Bonanno claims he was protecting his own fighter, but it's pretty clear from the replay that Meyer was trying to break up the fight, not start it. You'll see it right here. And Bonanno used the opportunity to take a cheap shot right there, just knocked him out of the ring. Meyer hitting right on the side of the head. If he was just trying to protect his fighter, why didn't he bother to jump on him after he's out of the ring? I mean, this guy's protected. Anyway, afterward, a local news reporter talked to Bonanno about the incident. As you'll see, Mr. Bonanno was just overcome with grief.
It's a regrettable incident, and it's unfortunate that it occurred, but sometimes in boxing those things happen, and I feel like I did what I was supposed to do in defending my fighter, and I felt like the trainer was attacking him, and he came forward, and as he went to swing at the fighter, I hit him.
Would you offer any apology for your actions?
Definitely not.
The fact that he even hit Meyer in the first place makes the incident, to use Leslie's word, regrettable. The fact that he continued to hit him when he was down could make it criminal, but the fact that he showed absolutely no remorse at all definitely makes it weenie. That's why we've selected Leslie as this week's winner of our Weenie of the Week Award. It was a regrettable incident that, yeah, that Leslie started.
Regrettable incident? That's what the Japanese said about Pearl Harbor.
It was a regrettable incident.
I don't know what happened.
It was regrettable.
Anyway. Master of the understatement.
Absolutely. He just hauled off and whacked that guy. It's time now to introduce you to our guest prognosticator for the week, week four of the NFL season.
Atlanta Green Bay.
They've lost their quarterback. I lived in Wisconsin. I'm going for Green Bay.
Green Bay, okay. Cincinnati and Kansas City.
I love the music in Kansas City. Kansas City.
Denver and Cleveland.
I love the weather in Denver, but I know they're playing at Cleveland, so it doesn't make any difference. Cleveland.
You like Cleveland. All right, Indianapolis at the New York Jets.
Well, now, I understand that USA Today favors the Jets by 3. Mm-hmm. So guess who I'm picking.
Good career move.
Dallas at the Cardinals. Well, you got that Cardinal connection.
I know you have.
What do you think?
Just because he's a Cardinal, you think that I'm going to vote for that?
It's a good move politically.
Oh, but it's
a good career move.
Doesn't affect me one single bit. I think that the Phoenix will beat Dallas.
Sports, of course, was Glenn's stock in trade. He made it look easy, but you will never know how hard he worked at it. Glenn had a unique ability in this confrontational business. He asked the tough question. But when the gloves came off for the interview, and the interview was over, Glenn and the person he was grilling always walked away friends.
Well, I'll carry a memory of a guy who was always upbeat, you know, just 100% up, smile on his face. And whenever he came to Redskin Park, no matter how serious we might be, he had a way of taking that seriousness out of the day and the situation. We'll miss him.
You know, somewhere in the near future, some other fortunate people are going to have the opportunity to have a sportscaster coming to them that will give them the insight, and he'll also provide them with a Weenie of the Week.
If it happened, it must have happened for the good, because I can't see anything happening for the bad when Glenn Brenner is concerned. It was just his time to go, and, you know, he's up there with a good man now. He's looking down upon us, and he's probably cracking the joke right now.
I think in so many ways he touched the life of everybody in the Washington area. Anyone that loved sports, loved life, you had to love Glenn because he was a fabulous human being.
When we look at reporting today, in order to be good, you have to be critical. You have to be malicious. But he was very, very good in a humorous way. Even when he was very critical, it was funny. It was not malicious, and I respect him for that, and that will be definitely deeply missed by me, and I think everybody in this community will miss that.
He could deflate the most pompous person going, and I think what made him even more special is he could deflate himself.
The things that I will remember about Glenn is a smile. I mean, there wasn't a time I didn't see him that he didn't have a smile on his face. He was always joking. I never saw him down.
I have strong beliefs that in his last months and in his last few days, I think he made a commitment to the Lord and gave his life to Christ. I believe that, and I was just talking today to somebody who was there with him. And that being the case, I know he's with the Lord. He's up there cheering us on.
Yeah, every once in a while, I was watching the sports on the late news, and I wanted to throw my shoe at him because he wouldn't give the basketball scores. You know, he's messing around or something on the set. But that's just Glenn. You know, that's how he was. And I'm just glad I got the chance to know him pretty well.
He made life just a little happier for me. And I know that he made it a little more comfortable for almost everybody that he ever met. He truly was one of a kind. That mold is broken. God bless you, Glenn Brenner.
One of the reasons we all had such affection for Glenn was because he spoke for the little child in us. As we grow up, many of us forget the child we once were and the way we were able to see the world with new eyes every day. Glenn didn't leave that little boy and him behind. With his innocence and wit, he could get away with the pranks and puns that the rest of the family couldn't. With his humor, he made sports and life fun for all of us. Glenn was like the little boy who stood at the side of the road watching the emperor go by. He looked up and said, "Hey, the emperor isn't wearing any clothes." But when Glenn said it, he would laugh, we would laugh, and even the emperor would laugh. Glenn was a big little brother to me. He was tall with the physical presence of an athlete, but he was also the little boy who loved to play baseball and to pull his big sister's pigtails. But this big little brother also had a big hug for me after the pigtail pulling.
There was not a phony bone in Glenn Brenner's body. He was the genuine article, the real McCoy. He had a killer's eye for the pretentious, the pompous, and the puffed up. He was highly intelligent and extremely intuitive. He generally knew what you were going to say before you said it. But when he shut up, which wasn't often, he was a good listener. He was fair and wide open and deadly honest. Lying to him was a risky business. First, the eyes would roll around in his head like BBs in a saucer, and then he would take the skin off the liar. He could be brutal. But show him a picture of a sick child, and you owned his heart. Glenn had a marvelous temper. It was Ralph Cramden-esque. When he went off, I generally found it uproariously funny. For some reason, my enjoyment of his rage never seemed to offend him. He was the most loyal of friends. If you told him something in confidence, it would stay with him forever. He was unashamedly, as Maureen said, unabashedly, a great big kid. He sought out the carefree child in all of us and taught us how to play. We're gonna miss you, pal. God, are we gonna miss you.
I can't lie, no more of your darkness. All my pictures seem to fade to black and white.
Well, one thing you can consider is...